You are listening to OffPlanet Radio at offplanetradio.com.
And welcome to Off Planet TV, Off Planet Radio, whenever, wherever, and however you are hearing this across the time zones of planet Earth, broadcasting live from the Netherlands over the Conscious Consumer Network. I'm Randy Moggins, and the show tonight's going to go in places we don't often go. We're going to go kind of political tonight. We're in a place right now here in the United States specifically, but even in terms of the global situation, where events are playing out pretty much in rapid fire succession now. And we need to deal with the realities of the times we live in. Certainly the events that occurred several weeks ago up in Oregon were a bellwether for the mood of the nation, at least in terms of the segment most visible, the patriot community, the militias, and those in America who have now stood up and said, we've had enough. We've watched our country eroded for so long. We've watched you dump our Constitution down the toilet. We've watched you burn the Declaration of Independence on the steps of the Supreme Court. And some of us are ready to stand up, and some of us may very well be ready to even die for those principles. And so as we go through the show tonight, you're going to hear a context in which to frame this that has to do with the elections. Certainly in terms of the most recent events, I would note the passage of Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia over the weekend as being one of those bellwether moments in history that has kind of a remarkable symmetry on one level, and on another, is kind of cloaked in mystery. The events surrounding post-mortem Justice Scalia's passing certainly mark in my mind as being strange and suspicious, but I'm not jumping onto the bandwagon of the conspiracy theorists out there with some of the wild-eyed things that I've heard them talk about over the last few days. There doesn't seem to be a lot of evidence at this point that Justice Scalia was murdered. The internet rumor mill immediately ran with wild rumors about, frozen ice bullets, heart attack guns, the pillow over the head. Obviously, the death itself was marked by post-mortem, the lack of an autopsy, and the very rapid apparent cremation of the body, which is strange given that Antonin Scalia is a Roman Catholic, which celebrates the rite of Christian burial. But none of that leads me to conclude right now, despite some of the better reporters out there, including John Rappaport, who are suspecting that he was murdered, that this is anything other than, quite frankly, the death of a man at age 79. But what we need to look at in the context of Justice Scalia's passing is, how are we assessing the people who lead our country? And so I've read probably dozens of articles on the passing of Justice Scalia, and probably the best one comes from somebody I respect a lot, Catholic writer Michael Hoffman, who has written an article on his website, revisionistreview.blogspot.com, entitled Justice Scalia's Sordid Simulacrum. I can say this word, simulacrum. And he says in the article, and I just wanted, this will segue very nicely into what my guests and I are going to talk about tonight. He says, quote, Traditional Catholics and allegedly conservative Protestants are engaged in ecstasies of praise for the life and career of the late Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia, who passed away at age 79 on February 13th. Some of Scalia's acolytes will expect this writer to hop on their bandwagon in light of the fact that Justice Scalia was the son of Sicilian immigrants, and by his own hard work and the high IQ, which God blessed him, he rose to the top of the judiciary in America. He and his wife had 9 children. He was said to be an opponent of abortion, illegal immigration, and some aspects of gun control. Legend has it that he was a proponent of a strict construction of the Constitution as it was originally written. Hoffman goes on to note in this article the fact that Scalia, while espousing to be a staunch conservative, he notes the following, quote, in 2000, in Bush versus Gore, Scalia employed the power of the Supreme Court to make a skull and bone snake the President of the United States. That snake then proceeded to foment 9/11 and the Purim Fest known as the invasion of Iraq, which resulted in the catastrophic decimation of Christianity in that Arab nation and the deaths of hundreds of thousands of people. The judge is not only guilty of cooperating with rabbinic halakha and the Babylonian Talmud, Mr. Scalia was an active participant in burnishing the reputation of those dark doctrines and spreading their diabolical influence, i.e. the Jewish influence over the politics of the United States. And that kind of frames some of what we're going to talk about tonight with my guest. Specifically the electoral process in the United States and what is happening and what is about to happen as America will, I'll just say, attempt to go to the polls, because the situation in the United States is so dicey right now that in some respects I wonder, do we get an election this year? My guest tonight is Jim Condit Jr. He was born in 1953 in Cincinnati, Ohio. He's the oldest of 11 brothers and sisters. He attended St. Margaret of Cortona Grade School. He later attended St. Xavier High School and Xavier University, 1971-73. He went on to found a successful printing business, which he ran from 1974 to 1989. Which he later sold. In 2012, he opposed Congressman and former House Speaker John Boehner as a Constitutional Party candidate in an election that saw him in second place and then mysteriously lose 33,000 votes and wind up in third place. He's been an ardent spokesman for pro-life, an organizer of Watch the Vote, and an early voice for 9/11 Truth when in 2002 he became the first political candidate in the USA to reach the public with over 50,000-watt stations with the message that the 9/11 cover story was false and that the evidence pointing to unsettling conclusions such as that there was a controlled demolition that had been used to bring down the World Trade Centers in New York City. He's continuing today to campaign actively for accountability and transparency in elections and is now urging Donald Trump to, quote, challenge the easily rigged secret computerized election counts and demand paper ballots counted in the open before the ballots leave the public site at each of the 200,000 polling places in the USA. And to talk about that tonight, we want to welcome to the air Jim Condit Jr. Welcome to Off Planet Radio.
Hello, Randy. Thanks for having me.
And if I missed anything in that recounting of your bio, elucidate us as we go forward. I wanted to give the listeners and viewers an overall view of who you are, where you've been, and what you've done in terms of specifically this subject, but also your view inside the political machine of America.
Okay. You know, that was good. That was more than enough bio. I may hit on some of the points in my life when I jumped off into being dragged into, you know, some of these realities that you're hinting at or talking about here. Mm-hmm. I was an alternate delegate to the Nixon convention in Miami, Florida at age 19. And as part of that, in those days, I guess they rented the mailing list of the delegates and alternates, because I got two books that really were quite influential in my life. I was almost, I had two more years to go in college, but these books actually touched on subject I really never heard. And the high school I went to, St. Xavier High School, was rated the 28th high school in the country at that time in intellectual, you know, I guess, achievement scores and things. But I had never heard anything about one of the books was Success Through a Positive Mental Attitude by W. Clement Stone, which talked about goal setting and that type of thing. And you know, kind of feet on the ground positive thinking. By that, I mean, you got to have reality thinking first, and then you try to find the best way forward, you know. And then the other book was None Dare Called Conspiracy by Gary Allen. And that book said that, among other things, I remember it was like a light bulb moment when it said that all the ABC, CBS, and NBC, at that time there were only three big TV networks, were all controlled by the same group, which they identified as the Council on Foreign Relations. Well, that was like, I thought, wow, if the same group controls all three networks, then they could be hiding a lot of stuff from us, because most Americans assume that, you know, you're getting a fair competition and they're really trying to beat each other to cover all the news and be first and be most accurate and be most truthful. But really, it turns out it's like Tide and Cheer with Procter & Gamble. In America, Procter & Gamble makes Tide and Cheer laundry detergents, and they're different names and I guess different formulas. But whichever you buy, Procter & Gamble gets the profit, you know. So this is kind of what's going on with the mass media in the United States. Now, somewhere along shortly thereafter, about 4 years later, I had been studying from the information that was in Gary Allen's book and groups that he recommended. And I had a friend who now passed away, Father James Wathen in Louisville, and he was in some of the same meetings. And I asked him, I said, who are the people doing this stuff? I mean, I can see that the groups back then, like the John Birch Society, could predict what was going to happen. We had a lot of information from behind the scenes. It was not in the, it was not emphasized in the major media. And I said, well, who's doing this stuff? So he sent me a book called, you know, I said, I don't know any people doing all this stuff. And so he sent me a book called, by Father Dennis Fahey, who was an Irish priest who had died in 1954. And it was called The Mystical Body of Christ in the Modern World. But in there, he talked about the battle of social organisms, you know, and not only he said there is an element of conspiracy in the world, but it's mainly a battle of social organisms. And he talked about the various social organisms, one of which was Talmudic Judaism. And I really, it took me a long time, several years, to accept that this could be the answer, because it's really the last thing you want to come to. It's like coming to a conclusion that's going to destroy your career, you know. There's a number of issues that I don't think people can understand the world, and you kind of touched on it with Michael Hoffman there, the internet writer, and he's written several books, but one of which is Judaism Discovered. The one before that was a smaller book called Strange Gods of Judaism. And Judaism Discovered is one of the two books that's been banned from Amazon that I'm aware of. His book was basically banned from Amazon. And what I think then when he tried to get it rectified, they said, well, we're going to bring it back as like a used book or a special book. And it cost $656.
Yeah, that's what they do when they want to bury something.
Yeah, so that was as good as banning it. So at any rate, but without understanding this Talmudic mentality, people cannot understand who would erect an election system and be able to put it over on the country. Who would go to the trouble, the detail, the years of patient planning to put an election system on the country that basically takes the voting power away from the people and puts it in a small group of people controlling several companies that really are probably the same company. Who would do 9/11? I mean, people can't imagine who would go to the trouble to do 9/11 and put out a false cover story and then cover up all the information that people really need to know. And basically weave a a nightmare tale or a fairy tale, Grimm's fairy tale or a nightmare tale, on what happened so that they can then lead the world into, as Lawrence Eagleburger, Henry Kissinger's, one of his two top assistants said, at 20 to 11 on the morning of 9/11, both buildings had fallen, one at 10:10, one at 10:30, and at about 20 to 11, on CNN, Lawrence Eagleburger said, the American people are going to have to, you know, learn two things. We're going to be at war in the Middle East for 50 years, and we're going to have to learn to give up our freedoms for security. Trade some of our freedoms for security. And at the time I thought, wow, they're really jumping on this thing. You know, they're really taking advantage of it. I didn't realize till later on that it had also been caused by the same crowd. So yeah. What is, so you can break it anytime you want, but I want to.
No, I'm enjoying your narrative here. It's a good condensed. Keep going.
Okay, so what needs to be understood is that there is this Talmudic mentality. Okay, and what is it? What is the Talmud first? My friend Michael Piper, Michael Collins Piper, who passed away, yes, unfortunately, at the age of 54 earlier this year, and wrote some of the very most important political books of our lifetime. He used to say, who put the mud in the Talmud? Well, the Talmud is a book that grew out of the rabbis who were, basically once Christ came and the rabbis rejected Christ, and they then developed over the centuries, maybe starting in Babylon 200 years before Christ, but they developed, especially after the time of Christ, this Talmud. And the Talmud says things that are actually, you can listen to Fox News or EWTN and they'll trash the Quran all day, all night and all day long, you know. Yeah. And there are some things in the Quran that I think are open to criticism for sure, that are not like the New Testament of Christianity, which are welcoming to all and don't talk about killing those who don't accept it, you know, if they don't accept it for free will. But the Quran is nothing compared to the Talmud. The Talmud says that only Jews are fully human, says it's okay to kill or cheat non-Jews if you can get away with it, says that Jesus dies five deaths every day in hell, says that Mary, the mother of Jesus, was a prostitute who had illicit relations with a soldier named Pindara, I believe is the name.
Which is a demonic name, by the way.
Is it okay?
Yeah, it is a demonic name, yes.
Okay. So this idea that only our group is fully human and the others aren't lead to be the, you know, kind of the green light to exploit these other groups for the benefit of the most important group. And this is, and I'm not saying that all Jewish people accept this idea, or that, you know, I don't know what percentage would. Most people in any religion do not really fully understand or fully believe the tenets of the religion they're in, but in any case, that is who has, you might say we have a bunch of sociopaths that have clawed their way to the top of the world, and the driving intellectual energy of this force is Talmudic Judaism. And again, I say that's about the last conclusion you want to come to if you want to have any kind of a career in the world now. So once that is understood, then people can kind of begin to understand the motive for some of the things we're seeing. So if someone is new to all this and they're hearing it for the first time, I would say that the first thing to look at is that there is an effect like a new type of country in the world, except it doesn't have any boundaries. And it's basically the international banks, Goldman Sachs, which is a commercial bank, by the way, Federal Reserve Board, which is the private company the United States has contracted with to issue our money since 1913. The Federal Reserve is so powerful that they've, since I think 2012, said we're not going to tell the president, the Congress, or the people how much money we're issuing into circulation. That's pretty powerful. Then you have IMF, the International Monetary Fund, and which seems to specialize in financially enslaving countries like in South America and Africa, and now Europe, under outrageous interest rates. And then you have the International Bank of Settlements in Switzerland and so forth. So these international banks and those controlling them form a new type of shadow government. It's a shadow government that is taking over the United States government and levers of power, and it comes more and more out into the open. Okay, so if we look at the White House today, we have in there for the last, I would say certainly for, since 1988, which is the last four presidents, very, very bluntly, the last three presidents, Clinton, W. Bush, and Obama, who are selling the United States out to the agenda of this, of these international banksters. Now, I would recommend this very responsible treatment of this subject by a guy named Bill Still, who put together two things that are on YouTube. If not, you can buy them really inexpensively. One is called The Secret of Oz, which talks about the Wizard of Oz and the symbols in there, which were it was symbols for the people fighting the bankers back in the 1890s or so. And it, but it goes into the control today of these banking systems. And then the other one is The Money Masters, or Money Masters by Bill Still, 3.5 hours. Well worth watching, though, if you can find the time. And there was an activist on the air the other week named Ken O'Keefe, who's quite a fiery speaker. And he said, you know, he gets emails that behind the banking system is the Jesuits or the Illuminati or the reptilians or the aliens or the Jews. But he said, whatever it is, the mechanism of control are these international banks, kind of under the principle of follow the money, because they can erect the think tanks. For instance, on the day that 9/11 happened, 2001, 2 days later, the Congress was handed a 2,000-page bill called, so it's called the Patriot Act, which should be called the Police State Act. Well, that thing was obviously written. That's a law, so it's not just like writing an essay. It's very got a very precise law, and it's that obviously was prepared way in advance of 9/11, so they can erect the think tanks, the assassination squads, by the media, by the and erect the election systems and so on and so forth. So that's kind of a backdrop. Now, so for the last 100 years, or so since 1913. When the United States Congress very unwisely contracted or appointed or by law delegated the power to issue our money, okay, in the United States to the Federal Reserve Board, which is a private company, then that we've progressively gone into a more of a situation like you were saying at the beginning, where this shadow government is trashing the rights of the people. And is trashing the Bill of Rights and trashing the Constitution. And so we talk about solutions of how to deal with this, which I'm sure we'll get into before the program's over. But that is kind of a backdrop for what is happening. And I don't know, that's just kind of a backdrop for people. Now, I'm running for Congress again. That's not really the focus of this show, but we got 10 points we're going to try to get out to the people in this.
No, I think it is actually an important point of the show. I think that's very germane to what we're talking about, because we need people who are in the process. So please go ahead.
Yeah. So what I run for Congress, for instance, this year. Boehner retired. I thought he would still be running. He isn't. But so we got 8 people, Republicans and so forth. And I'm on the ballot till November as a independent third party candidate, because I wanted to be on till November. Yeah, I would be glad to win if that could happen. But I'm what I know I can do for sure. And I would try to win if there was a path to do so and we got attracted the money to do so. And I'm going to try to win anyway. But my point is that what I know I can do is get radio ads on the air and get our programs on the air over 50,000 watt radio stations, and hit the people who are not, do not yet understand that they can't trust the big media. They have to look onto the internet to the responsible sites and responsible programs like you're running to get what's really going on. And there's a lot of people who don't yet realize this, even though thankfully a widening circle of people do realize this. So, but a lot, I'm a little bit amazed that a lot of people who are kind of veterans of fighting the truth battle on whatever front, whether it be health freedom or 9/11 or whatever it is, they do not see the value of getting onto the air on the big 50,000 watt radio stations and even TV stations, if possible, and reaching out to the rest of the population. Now, I assure you the other side understands this, because I always face guerrilla warfare when I try to get on these stations. The other side doesn't want the type of things we're talking about here to even have 1 minute on the air. They don't want the public to hear this for 1 minute, and they will go to lengths if they can to prevent it. Now, there's a law called the Reasonable Access Law, which everybody in the United States should know about. And if you're on the if you're running and are a qualified candidate for Congress, Senate, U.S. Senate, or President, or the judiciary, okay, federal judiciary, that is, the FCC licensed stations like ABC, CBS, NBC, the Fox, the not Fox Cable, but the Fox, other Fox,
Fox network stations, yeah.
Yeah, and all the radio stations, which most of the big ones are now owned by Clear Channel, but they have to accept your ads. They cannot refuse your ads. They have to give you reasonable access or equal access with businesses. So I can't go in and say, I want you to play my ad at 1:42 on the Rush Limbaugh show on Tuesday afternoon in Cincinnati. But I can say, what is your rules for Rush Limbaugh? Can a business, and they might say, well, a business can buy one radio ad an hour on Rush Limbaugh. Okay, so I want, if I can afford it, I want one radio show an hour. And then they got to run them, you know, they have the computers now do a good job in spacing the ads, so you don't get like three ads in 10 minutes, but one will be the 12 to 1 hour, one to, and that's what we want, hundreds of people across the country to run for Congress and do what I'm doing. And that is get, I don't care what issue, there's plenty of issues that need, the public needs to hear about, you know. And then of course you leave them with a website, and then that can, that does open up a whole new world of information to many people. So that's what should be happening in 100 cities across the country. It's not. Now, some people feel that Donald Trump is opening up areas of discussion that no one else is opening. He's not going as far as we're going to be going on the show, and I don't know what he really understands about some of these things. But he is opening some discussions that apparently the establishment really doesn't like. So that's at least how it appears to me and many other people I'm talking to. And you have all kinds of people, such as Michael Medved, who's a secondary talk show host, really are going at lengths every day to trash Trump and try to get people not to support him. So this gives Karl Rove, Bill Kristol, the Weekly Standard. This makes me think that they are not happy with the types of discussions he's opening.
Oh, they're not only not happy. I can tell you specifically in the case of Bill Kristol, they're very threatened by what Trump represents and what he could do. You got to remember the guys like Bill Kristol, he put his signature on the PNAC documents back in 1999, which basically was the blueprint for 9/11 that sat there in plain view. And was not vetted, has never been vetted in the mainstream media. So people like Bill Kristol are very worried about what Trump could do if he decides to go in and open up the inquiry into 9/11 and begin to, you know, scrutinize what really occurred on that day, specifically with Cheney and people inside the administration.
Right. And that's the project for a new American century, the new American century.
Right.
And
right.
Barbara Honegger, who was a top research assistant to Reagan, in fact, sat above him, one floor above him in the White House. I had lunch with her a few years ago on another DVD I put out called The Nazi Zionist Connection. And she said that we're talking about 9/11 too. And she says she left the Reagan administration in 1985 or six, I think. And she's a independent thinker. And she said that PNAC, Project for a New American Century, became the government once Bush took over. In other words, the people that signed that document, which might have been several hundred, I'm not sure, they became the government. You know, many of those people that signed that document or in that group became the government when W. Bush took over. And then, of course, 9/11, and then on to all the other things that led to. So that's one thing. One thing we're going to be talking about is the Talmudic mentality. Without understanding that motive, it's difficult to understand what is happening and why so many things seem to be going wrong and why people are not getting the information that they should give. The second thing we're going to talk about is who controls the five big TV networks. That would be ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, and Fox. Well, thanks to Brother Nathaniel Kapner, who you may, I'm sure you've probably heard of. Brother Nathaniel is a Jewish guy who converted to Russian Orthodoxy, okay? And yeah, he exposes all this stuff. And he put out an article that is really valuable that went through the five TV networks, who controls them. And then they're all, in effect, secular Talmudic Jewish mentalities. And he also put the article from the mainstream news media covering when these individuals took over. So one is from the Wall Street Journal, one's from the New York Times, one's from the Bloomberg and so forth. So he's got all five documented that all five of our networks are run by individuals of what some people might call the Zionist, I would call the Talmudic Jewish mentality. So if Muslims ran all five TV networks, if any group did, if any group did, it's worth the people knowing about. And so that's the second thing, because if you're getting information, and we furthermore say that these groups, and we want others to start saying, these individuals who are running these networks need to be arrested for treason and for corruption of minors. Because the treason is blocking information from the American people that they need in order to stay free. So this is the if they were catering to a foreign country to help subdue the American people and all other peoples, that would clearly be treason in everybody's mind. But since they're catering to the international banker agenda and the international banker nexus of power, that's also treason. These heads of these networks and many people in the federal government and even in Congress need to be arrested and put on trial. And we want people to start talking about this openly because they are betraying the American people. And so, for instance, when we had someone who was brutally suppressed by the media, Ron Paul, running for president, yeah. And there's some good videos up. Ron Paul was cheated out of the presidency. It's incredible. They just didn't mention him for a long time, and that's can be a whole subject in itself. But Ron Paul was brutally suppressed in favor of puppets like Romney and Obama and so on and so forth. So that's one example. Another example is all the information that was hidden from the American people about 9/11. And your audience is probably familiar with that, the collapse of Building 7, that steel cannot melt and disappear. It really disappeared at temperatures that jet fuel can get to. Jet fuel is about 600 or 800 degrees shy of what is needed to melt steel, let alone make it disappear, which happened, and the cover up and all that kind of stuff. So that's a second subject that the who controls our mass media, and the same goes for Clear Channel, which Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, and so forth. A former Mossad agent named Arit Gadesh, a woman, at least until recently, wrote the checks for Clear Channel. So Clear Channel bought up all the big radio channel stations before 9/11, 01, and that was so that there would be no dissent when that happened, and there wasn't. I mean, I was a caller, and there were a few other callers, but the media was 1,000% behind George Bush going into Iraq. I mean, there was no dissent. And then later the New York Times said, oh, we maybe were derelict in our duty. Derelict in our duty. You at the New York Times and the media was leading the charge to make sure that this destabilizing war, and as the former Congressman James Trafficant said, unfortunately passed away under somewhat mysterious circumstances in September of 2014. He said, once we went to the Mideast, we're conducting Israel's expansionist policy, and everybody's afraid to say it. So 9/11 is a third subject that we have to bring up, because if people don't understand 9/11, not only that it was an inside job, it was more like a job of Israeli spies in the United States who had usurped the White House and the Defense Department and so forth. that really is who did 9/11. It isn't, people recoil from that because they think, gee, Americans wouldn't do that to Americans. Well, they did have American citizenship, but it's again this Talmudic mentality.
There's a lot of, and again, you know, as well as I do, a lot of these people sitting inside government are dual citizens. Including Michael Chertoff, who was head of Homeland Security, who was a dual Israeli citizen, which, you know, if we lived in a righteous country and our history was a bit different, the 13th Amendment would have prohibited that dual citizenship, and that man would not be able to hold any kind of public office.
Right, and he was one of the main offenders. And then the guy who was running the money at the Pentagon, Rabbi Dov Zakim, is a name most people have never heard.
Yeah. Doug Zakim, yes. Yep.
Now, if he had been Reverend Jerry Smith or Father Michael Murphy, the Jewish media, ABC and so forth, would have been screaming to high heaven, separation of church and state. But this guy, $2.3 trillion went missing under his watch. Rumsfeld said that the day before 9/11, we're missing $2.3 trillion. Yet not one in 10,000 Americans have ever heard the name Dov Zakim. So these guys are, they're there. The media, they're tribesmen, and the media protects them. And this is a criminal element, relatively small, certainly compared to mankind, relatively small compared to the Jewish community as a whole. But they're a criminal element that needs to be exposed. I sometimes say that if, you know, I'm 1/4 Sicilian, I'm a half Irish and Scottish or Welsh, and 1/8 and 1/8 German, and 1/4 Sicilian, Italian. And I sometimes jokingly say, if I wasn't part Sicilian, I couldn't think like these criminals. But if somebody said to me, if somebody was exposing that the mafia a few generations ago, that they had to look in the Sicilian Italian community to find out who was running the mafia. And if I said, how dare you attack my heritage? Because I'm part Sicilian Italian, then I hope people would think either one, I'm in on the mafia and trying to protect them, or two, I'm crazy. I'm insane, because attacking a criminal element within the Jewish community and small at that is not attacking anything but that criminal element. You know, so they need to be focused on, arrested, and stopped from wielding this tremendous financial power over mankind. So. We've talked about the Talmudic mentality, who controls the TV networks, and 9/11, and who runs the big TV networks. That's four things. And then the fifth thing we got to get into is, are elections real anymore? Who controls the elections? Who counts the votes? Who's allowed to see the ballots on election day? Is Victoria Collier, the daughter of Ken and Jim Collier, who passed away now. Jim and Ken passed away in the 90s. They wrote the book Vote Scam, The Stealing of America. Virginia Collier, the daughter of Jim, says, you can't vote the bums out because you didn't vote the bums in. So I don't know if you're coming up on that break or not, but maybe that's the next subject we can tackle here.
You know, let's do that. Why don't we take a break here, and then we'll come back in about 6 or 7 minutes and start to unpack all this, give the listeners a chance to digest a little bit. So I'm sure Biggie's queuing us up here, and we'll take a break. We'll come back. Segment two of OffPlanet TV, which I think is going to be a real rocket sled when you see where this is all going to go. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the second half of Off Planet Radio, Off Planet TV. The website, in case I didn't mention it before, is offplanetradio.com. That's where you can find the show archives and occasional blog posts and things that are going out on the website. We're also on Facebook. You can find us there. And the shows also are going out on iTunes these days. Yes, we reactivated the iTunes feed, so those of you with iDevices and other similar things can pick up this show as well. We're going deep politics tonight. This is a kind of uncomfortable subject. This is, as I was pointing out to my producer on the break, this is where I began in 2003, basically going on to shortwave radio, talking then about AIPAC, the Israeli presence in the United States, and the religious indoctrination that's going on as well, because at that time I was on Christian shortwave radio, and I watched how Christianity was being diluted and prostituted as they stooped lower and lower to basically worship the Talmudic influences in their churches. And we saw the rise of John Hagee and what he did in the founding of Christians United for Israel, a so-called Christian lobby group, which was nothing more than a front for more fundraising for the Israeli lobbies. So it's an old subject. It's one we have to keep going back to because it is part of the peril that America faces. My guest with me tonight, Jim Condit Jr., coming to us from Ohio. And we're gonna rapidly spin through a number of things that we sort of outlined in the first segment of the show. Jim, welcome back to the show. And let's just go for it.
Okay, let me try to, I'll go through the other subjects that we think have to be emphasized so people can get a clue to what's wrong and what we need to do to fix it. So election fraud. Most people say voter fraud because it's just instinctive and that's what the media says, but that's really not what we're really primarily worried about. Yes, there are a few people that Acorn organizes and they run around and vote 2 and 3 times or maybe 10 times. That's a problem. Could easily be fixed because you don't allow instant same day registration unless you want fraud. But the real problem is election fraud from the vendors who run the elections for our county. So incredibly enough, and people can go to openlettertodonaldtrump.com, which is a website we erected a few months ago. And it has on there, it's an open letter to him, but it's also an open letter to all the other candidates and all Americans. And it has to do with how our elections are run right now. So around 1973, computers came in. Now, older people remember that Nixon, who was not the most attractive candidate in the world, Nixon beat George McGovern, who was running on kind of a socialist platform, 49 states to one. McGovern won Massachusetts, Nixon won every other state. That was before there were computers. And in 1973, computers started to go in. And the older generation was just mesmerized. They loved the computers. The younger generation understands how easily they can be rigged. But the older generation was like, wow, magic. This is easy. And the powers that be, the banking shadow government that we were talking about earlier, erected companies that were billion-dollar companies, and they came into to counties. All our elections in the United States are run at the county level, so there's 50 states, about 3,142 counties. And the counties decide how the voting's done. Well, between 1973 and 1988, over a period of about 15 years, every county in the United States basically adopted computers, with the exception of 5 in New Hampshire and maybe a few other rural counties here and there. And every major city adopted computers. So you'd think, well, gee, I guess it was like maybe 3,000 computer companies. No. What happened was there was basically 4 computer companies. And by the 90s, these became known as election systems and software. That's ES&S out of Omaha, Nebraska, which counts 60% of the American vote on election night. Diebold, which everyone's heard of because one of their leaders made a statement in 2004, like, we're gonna make sure George W. Bush is reelected. Yeah, and Diebold then started to back out of the
gaffe,
yeah. And they make these gaffes all the time. They just don't get reported. It's kind of like, if anyone has not heard it, go on the internet and put in John F. Kennedy's secret society speech, which was to the New York the newspaper man, and he talked about how this conspiracy that we're fighting, their mistakes are covered up, not aired. And a great little speech there that he gave in 1961 to the newspaper men of America. But at any rate, so you had you have these three Diebold Hearts, now it's Heart Civic or Heart Inner Civic out of Texas, and Sequoia. Okay, so there's four companies, and this is in an article linked on, if you go to the open letter to DonaldTrump.com, there's articles, one in The Nation in 2004 that go over this, and you can read the first few paragraphs and get the gist. Well, now in 2013, a company called Dominion, bought Diebold and they bought Sequoia. So now there's only three companies. So we, on the open letter to DonaldTrump.com, you can go to Election Night Gatekeepers, okay? And Election Night Gatekeepers, you'll find the, what we finger is the 12 Election Night Gatekeepers, which are the Republican National Committee and the Democratic National Committee, because they control every, either one of them or a combination controls all 3,142 counties in the United States. They're the ones who've encouraged their county leaders, hey, adopt these three companies. These are good companies. They'll make election nights easy for you, which they do. So those two entities, Republican National Committee and Democratic National Committee, have obviously encouraged their secretaries of state and all the people in the counties to hire these three companies, which they count about 96% of the American vote. There's other smaller companies, which I kind of suspect are fronts for these larger companies, but basically those three companies dominate. So then the companies that dominate and that have been hired, they haven't broken their way in with fisticuffs or by illegal means. They've been hired by 3,137 out of these 3,142 counties, or close to that, to run and process our votes on election night. Okay. So that again is ESNS and Heart Civic, and the third one is called is now called Dominion. Okay, Dominion. So that's five. Then the next six companies that are involved in election night gatekeepers are ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, Fox, and AP Wire, which is where all your local papers from that, and Reuters, right, and a few others. All the local papers get their national and international news, and all the local stations. So then those six are the ones that announce the vote on election night. So they're, and the reason most people have never heard of ESNS or Dominion or Hart is because this whole system is protected from the view of the American people. And then the last gatekeeper is a company called National Election Pool, which used to be called Voter News Service. Now it's, then they got so stinky in 2003 after the Bush-Gore thing. It's all the same people, same money, same location. Voter News Service, without changing anything else, changed their name to National Election Pool. And they are the ones that basically get the count on election night from the three companies and pass it on to the TV networks who announce it to the public. And National Election Pool is owned by ABC, CBS, NBC, CNN, Fox, and AP Wire. So not one in 100,000 Americans probably has heard of National Election Pool, yet they are solely in charge of announcing the vote at congressional, senatorial, and presidential elections. So you might say, well, okay, well, they're running. How does this work on election night? Well, you go and vote, like in Ohio, and I think you'll find is the same in Pennsylvania. We go and vote, and then some places they run it through scanners on the spot, which still the people cannot see the ballots as they're running them through the scanners.
Right. Yeah.
But in Cincinnati, we are in Ohio, we go and feed them into an ATM machine type machine, which eats the ballot. And then you don't see the ballot again, unless there's a recount 21 days later. So on election day, no citizen, no candidate, no local press person can see any of the ballots. So we vote, we put them in these systems that take the ballots away from the people, right? And then no one sees any ballots. So when we hear the results announced on election night, it is a total act of blind faith on our part, except in those five counties in New Hampshire, that we're getting the right count. So on the election of Romney and Obama in 2012, not that I wanted to be joined at the hip with either one of those by any means, but it was neck and neck, and all the many computers broke down in major cities, according to Bev Harris of Black Box Voting, about 10 till 10, and then Obama shot ahead. Karl Rove actually objected on the Fox News Network on camera with Megyn Kelly. He said, this can't be right. And he challenged the results initially. And she went, put on her mobile mic and went off to get the statisticians. Well, before they could arrange the on-screen debate, they had called more stuff. But all this is you're trusting in the announcement of these election night gatekeepers, okay? And there was no recount in almost anywhere, so ballots were never looked at. So you'd say, well, what if somebody does want to recount? Okay, well, then you've got to wait 21 days, plenty of time to switch the ballots. They got sophisticated machines that can count thousands of ballots. You know, if you've ever been at the bank and they you're getting a few hundred or whatever dollars back, and they'll run it through the machine to count it real quick. Mm-hmm. It's like lightning speed counting. Well, right, that's how right. they can do count ballots, and they can also print ballots almost as fast. So 21 days is plenty of time to switch the ballots to make the published computer count come true, right? If you're trying to steal the city, the county, the state, and the world. Remember the title of the book.
My question
is Stealing of America. Yeah, go ahead.
Jim, how did we lose control of this in the first place? Now, I will admit, I grew up in a small town in a rural county. I grew up in this in the late 60s, early 70s. The first time I voted was paper ballot inside of a boothed curtain, a curtain booth. Basically go in and it was a paper ballot. It was sort of like a punch card system. My understanding of that process was all of that was collected in secured boxes and then handed to tabulators on the premises who were certified public officials for counting. When did we go to a system where these corporate interests took over our counting and tabulating of our votes?
What you were voting on was actually already a horrible system, okay?
It was a horrible system, yes.
The punch cards were already, they had total control because they took the ballot, and we could go into that. The Colliers and myself were talking about hanging Chad in 1985. You just couldn't get any publicity until 2000 when they wanted to cover
right.
it so that they could get in these even worse systems, or I should say not worse, but more easily controlled. So between 1973 and 1988, as each county switched over, that's when we lost control. There was no more. See, a paper ballot is not good enough. And most of the United States still has paper ballots. Now, incredibly, in that Nation article in 2004, the veteran reporter Ronnie Duggar, who is very good on this issue, he claims that 36 million votes that year were counted on paperless touchscreens like they're going to use this Saturday in the South Carolina primary. There's no paper in South Carolina primary coming up this Saturday. People go in and touch a screen. There's no paper. It's the most absurd thing you can imagine. There's no chance for a recount. No way to check anything. You just got to believe that your little bleep of energy and the other millions of people that vote or however many vote in South Carolina, you just got to believe that that is what their machines are recording. Okay. So that it's total absurdity. We're being treated like slaves in a communist state or in a tin horn dictatorship. But that's when the control was lost completely. And, as I say, now here's another thing that has got to be said so people understand. So we vote, votes are snatched away. It's run through allegedly the computerized software, easily rigged secret software, which we don't know who programs any of these computers. We don't know who wrote the software. And the courts have consistently protected these four companies from scrutiny. Okay. But even if two things, even if you have a paper ballot or if you get a receipt, that means nothing. You know how you voted. The receipt right. you get out of the machine, just because the paper says how you voted doesn't mean that's what was recorded in the machine. The machine can be programmed to give you your right receipt, but still switch your vote to somebody else. And in addition to that, even getting a receipt doesn't help at all because I know how I voted. I don't know how I want to know how the 10,000 people in my city,
right,
the 8 million
exactly.
people in my state and the 100 million people. So what has to be done and what we got to get back to is, and it could easily be done tomorrow, this week, if all the counties wanted to do it, you say computers out, all you companies out, machines out. We're going to go to paper ballots, put into a box, preferably a clear box. We're going to with a,
right.
a clear plastic box, but at least a box that has no false bottom. And then you at each of the 200,000 polling neighborhood polling places like you vote at and I voted at or vote at, then you dump the ballots out at closing time, and people pre-selected from that neighborhood precinct, Democrats, Republicans, yes. Independents, Green, yes. Constitution, they all count the votes, those who were pre-designated, and they get paid to do it, by the way, so it's a job everybody wants. And all the other factions can watch at close range as long as they don't disrupt. And other good things could be done, too, to make sure that people could watch the count on the internet if they actually wanted a fair count. But let's, you know, you could have cameras in the ceiling as they did it, streamed over the internet, people there live watching. That's what has to be done. Then you post the results right at the precinct, and then the other thing, the candidates and the public interest groups have to realize, and the citizens should realize, then you check at the county, at the county level and at the state level to make sure, and at the national level to make sure those who are tabulating the votes tabulate them properly. But if everything is done in public at the precinct level, and I believe there should be a national holiday Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, because this is the most important thing we do as citizens, is decide who's going to be running the country. So we should have Monday to lobby each other and educate each other, Tuesday to vote and count the votes, and Wednesday to recover in case it's a late night count. And that would be very appropriate. So that's the situation there. One other thing I want to say on this subject before moving on to the others quickly is that, believe it or not, again, I tell people when I tell them this, I can't blame you if you don't believe me. This sounds like I'm making up like the most horrible nightmare of the stupidest people in the history of the world. But the counties, our election officials, sign a contract with these three big companies that they are not allowed to inspect the software that tells the computers what right. to do.
Right, exactly.
So I have the Secretary of State of Ohio, John Husted. I have him on tape in 2012, and we're going to put it up. Well, I got to try to do that tonight. I got to get that up before the South Carolina primary this weekend. We've had it for a few years. And I asked him a question of this nature, and I said, aren't we running illegal elections when we're secretly counting the vote, which is outlawed by three Supreme Court decisions, you know, right. was ruled against by right. three, and is also against many state laws overtly, and against common sense, and against the Declaration of Independence, against the Constitution by common sense. Aren't we running illegal elections when we let private companies running it on software that the counties have signed a contract that they won't even look at what the source code of the software? And he said, he looked at the podium before a few hundred Tea Party people and said, that's a problem. And he said, if people would file suit, maybe we could do something about it.
Well, so let me just say this, because you just hit on something that I've been saying for years, and I don't think that the using computer systems for voting are a good idea. That having right. been said, I don't think any software that is used in the public domain, that is used for public purposes in political or government activity, should be anything less than fully open source and inspectable by people who want to look at the code. And that's
absolutely
the problem, is proprietary code. It's the same problem we have with banking right now. We've handed over our privacy and our financial transactions to computer code that's completely locked down. So
exactly.
That's a tangent, but it does go along with. And by the way, if you see we get that link, we'll help push that video out as well. It'd be interesting.
Okay, yeah, that we'll put that on Donald open letter to DonaldTrump.com,
okay,
and it'll
good.
Be a YouTube video as well. Okay.
Okay.
So
excellent.
That's that. The same thing. The good point you just brought up, though, very important point. The same secrecy that the Federal Reserve has operated with is the same secrecy that the election establishment yeah. operates with. So whenever this international banking crowd takes over something, they want everything to be secret from the people and so far away from the people that you don't even know who to go to complain to. But if we counted it back at the neighborhood polling places, that would put it right where everyone can participate and be involved. And it would be really be exciting. The Colliers used to say one of the counting positions in each neighborhood should be reserved for a high school senior or a college student to teach the next generation how yeah. votes must be counted. So then let's move on to some of these others real quickly. So we don't want to just preach gloom and doom. It's within our power within the next 2 years to begin to take our country back, or even sooner. There's a thing called the precinct system that we got to educate. And a lot of people know about this. Now, thankfully, I put out a video called The Strangest Political Secret in 2008 that got over 100,000 views back then. And but the idea is you got your 50 states, 142 counties. Like Ohio has 88 counties, Iowa has 99, and so forth. Florida has 67, and in those counties are all divided up into precincts, and those are little little geographical boundaries, countries, little boundaries, and that's where you and I, all of us, live in a precinct, and there's about 200,000 precincts. That's where our polling place is, okay?
Yes.
Our polling place, all the people at our precinct or our little neighborhood precinct vote at the same place. So there's an election for the Democrats and Republicans run every county, so we got to deal with them. There's a precinct election each spring or summer in all the precincts in all the states, and either by caucus or by primary. And we need 200,000 people in both parties, patriots, constitutionalists, to run and take over those precincts. You run either by caucus or by ballot, and usually the results are like 52 to 24 or 11 to 6, very small vote counts because you're just dealing with neighborhoods. And then a month after, let's say the Ohio primary is in May, it's in March this year, but a month after that primary, you go to Republicans go on one night and Democrats another, or they go on the same night to different places, and they elect the county chairman. The county chairman then decide how the votes counted. They decide who the state chairman are going to be a little bit down the road. They decide who the national chairman is going to be, and then the national chairman and the state chairman set the rules for the presidential primaries. So we have a pamphlet out called the precinct, the most powerful office in the land, which is about this precinct thing. So we don't need to go straight to the Second Amendment and like the Bundys tried out in the West, and I support their efforts, but they're hopelessly outnumbered right now, because people are not alert as to what's going on. Their cause was certainly just, but because of the federal government owning all this federal land, they're not supposed to even own. But
right, yeah.
The precinct system is the peaceful constitutional way, and we have set up, Randy, this is very important, and you know the person now who set it up, one of the most tireless patriots in the country, who's also setting up another system you're aware of. And she had my vision for 10 years. She brought it into being. It's called networkamerica.org. Networkamerica.org. Everyone could go right now, sign up by state and county, and then we would organize by county and try to take over both the Democrat and Republican parties, open up the voting system, and then that would open it up to independents and third parties. So that people say, oh, we can't do anything, or, everyone's going to rich restaurants or eating out and going around having a good time. Oh, we can't do anything. The other side's so powerful. That's a bunch of baloney. People just don't know what to do. And many of them maybe are still trying to put off doing anything. But if they want to know what to do, you can go to networkamerica.org, join the groups we have, or start your own group. But we need to organize online and then physically in each county. You run for precinct. Everybody should either be running for precinct or supporting someone who's a constitutionalist who's running for precinct. And then you get into these parties, throw out the current leaders, restore honest voting, send good men to Congress. And then within 4 or 5 months, Randy, we could undo all these horrible laws that they've made in the last 50, 60 years. It might take a little longer than that, but the precinct, and we could install honest money. We could, by the provisions that are in the original Federal Reserve Act, we could disengage from the Fed. There's a way to do that in the original act.
Yes, there is.
And then institute an honest national monetary fund. And that's the next subject I wanted to touch on real quickly, is honest money. Because Jim Trafficant, the former congressman from Youngstown, Ohio, who unfortunately, as I say, passed away in a strange tractor accident September 2014. Trafficant was about to launch a Project Freedom USA, which was for doing away with the IRS and to institute honest money. Now, let me talk about this just for a second. And I don't know if you've heard this, but the other thing that my campaign will announce will at least be one campaign pushing it, is how we can institute honest money and really get out of this so-called economic doldrums. Or now, Sean Hannity was on today saying that some of the big financial papers and leaders, we're headed for another hiccup, another downturn.
This isn't going to be a hiccup. It's going to hurl this time.
Yeah, right. And I shouldn't have said hiccup, but it's like we're going to have this big downturn. Right. Maybe there's going to be no rescue this time. Well, this is all artificial manipulation by the bankers because
there won't be a rescue. There won't be a rescue this time. The Federal Reserve announced that months ago. It was on the front page Zero Hedge. They said, okay, we're not going to bail you out this time because they can't bail themselves out this time.
Well, so this is the point is we got the same amount of people, same amount of trees, same amount of resources, same amount of everything, but suddenly we're not going to have any cash. So we're going to have a desperate, maybe even a starving society. Now, there is a system that is terribly named for the United States because it sounds like you're going to say socialism. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. It's called social credit is what it was called in England, Canada, and in Australia. And I am a believer in that system. And so we can back the currency by hard metals because the Constitution at least seems to say that as far as this.
It does indeed. Yes. Yes.
So we can back the. But the question is that I've never heard any other system address how much money should be in circulation. The Federal Reserve has their own formula, but it's not known. Austrian economics, as far as I know, does not address it at all. How much money, if they said right now, Randy, you and Jim, me and a few other people, you run the Federal Reserve. We're going to get rid of them, put in the National Monetary Office. You run it now. I didn't know what I would do until I ran into the system. But basically what this system basically says is, of course, the nation should issue money at no interest to the nation. Right now, they're issuing money, charging us big interest. Secondly, the money should about equal the goods and services that are available. The money in circulation should about equal the goods and services, as close as you can get. Because if you have too much money versus goods and services, you have inflation and maybe hyperinflation. If you have too little money, like now, you have stagnation or deflation. And right now, according to the experts that I trust, there's about $6 trillion too little cash in the pockets of the middle and lower class. And this makes some people at first glance, they recoil from it. But there's only two ways that I've ever heard. I'm glad to hear other ideas on how to get money into circulation. And C.H. Douglas, who constructed this system in 1917-1918, he saw that we could no longer get enough money into the circulation through wages. And he said, what's going to happen when we have machines are doing more and more of the work, as is happening right now, and computers are doing more and more of the work, and we don't need the whole workforce anymore. So there's two ways we can bring money into circulation. The first is what we've been doing since 1696, when the Rothschilds took over the Bank of England, and that's the big banks issue it to the medium banks, who issue it to the local banks, who then issue it to the businesses, who then issue it to the people. There's actually some other ways they're getting money into circulation, or we would be in having food riots. But that's one way. And the second way is to figure up every 3 months or every 6 months the GNP versus the money in circulation. And as the economy is growing and as more people come into the world, for instance, we had 180 million people in 1960 when Kennedy ran against Nixon. I was 7 years old, and I always remembered that they said we had 180 million people. Well, now we have 320 million in the United States, so obviously you need more money.
Many of whom are not citizens, by the way.
Yeah, many are not. Yeah, but let's just say for the sake of argument, whatever number you want to pick that is citizens. So you then have a GNP, which is now $15 trillion, I believe, roughly, and when you take all the wages, all the Social Security, all the welfare, all the unemployment, and you got about $9 trillion in circulation. So Douglas said what needs to be done is, instead of letting the banks issue it and take all the cream off the top, you know, the international banks, you say, okay, we need to put a dividend to the people. In other words, the dividend will make up the difference, so there's enough cash in circulation. That dividend would be issued to each person, let's say over 25 years old, based on the goods and services that the machines and the computers or everything.
Well, now you just stepped into the actual antithesis of what we currently have. See, part of the problem right now is we have a baseline currency that does not ever produce anything beyond itself to pay back interest that's accrued on the funds that are put out by the Federal Reserve. I like that idea because it actually spins it the other way. We've got to remember something. the dual-headed hydra here is interest and taxes. Now, usury, however you define that, is considered to be a sin. And we have lived on usury, which goes back to this whole Talmudic system again, by the way. And then on top of that, there's the issuance of currency, which is always just slightly shy of the ability to ever pay back money that was borrowed. The United States has the ability to issue currency without interest to the people.
Right. Right,
so exactly. Somewhere in all of that, we have a working framework to go forward with this. The recalcitrance comes obviously from the vested interests of the bankers, the politicians, and the oligarchs at the top.
Right, right, exactly. And Trafficant he looked at this whole system.
Yes,
and
he
said, you know, what we can say, he was like, you know, like maybe Trump is, or some of these people, what can we say that the people understand? And he said, all we can really say is that if we have a surplus, it'll be issued, money will be issued at no interest. But if we have a surplus, it will be issued back to the people in the form of a dividend. Actually, though, as you get more goods and services, there has to be some mechanism to get money in circulation so there's enough money to purchase those goods and services. So, and you might not have a dividend every quarter, every year. Some years the economy might go backwards.
Just
but
like
the point
stocks.
Is that would then, so that's a big subject. There's a book online, there's an article online called The Money Myth Exploded. There's another book free online, all this is free, called This Age of Plenty by Louis Evin, E-V-E-N, and that's a good book to read on this. And you could have very various variations, but I've never heard any other way to get money into circulation than either through the international banks, as we've done since 1696, or by the dividend at no interest to the people. Let me say one other thing about this. If you had a rich uncle who died, okay, and somebody came to you and said, Randy, this rich uncle left you a trust fund, and you're going to get a $1,600 check a month, which is about what the experts in social credit tell me would be issued now to the people in the United States. So you're going to get a $1,600 check a month, let's say people over 25. And you said, oh, wow, I didn't know I had a rich uncle. Well, this dividend that the people that I feel are honest and accurate are saying would be issued right now to make up the $6 trillion deficit in the cash in the pockets of the people. Who's our rich uncle? Our rich uncle is Henry Ford, Thomas Edison, Steve Jobs, the millions of people that have made innovations from the molds that make the chairs we sit in, to computers, to cars, you name it, clothing, all the innovations that have been made as civilization progressed. All those people that advanced technology or inventions or how to make things in the physical world, that's our rich uncle. And right now, all mankind should benefit from the heritage of mankind through that dividend. And then everyone, the reason it's not socialism is there's no central planning. See, people are falling for Bernie Sanders and socialism, which is a mask for the banksters, because they don't know a third way. They think they got to choose between vulture capitalism on Wall Street, which they hate, A, and B, they have to choose between, or they got to choose socialism or communism. Pope Pius XI actually wrote in his encyclical in 1931, said if ownership is concentrated in fewer and fewer people, the everyday people will tend to fall victim to listening to the siren song of socialism and communism, which is another mask for the same people that are the vulture capitalists. So
I'm glad you brought that up. Can I sidetrack you here for a minute?
We're not going to get penalized
for time on this. I need to know what you think about the present Pope and some of the statements that he's made, because when you mentioned that statement by Pope Pius, it seems in some ways that Francis right now is issuing documents that seem to indicate he's going in that direction. Is it your opinion that Pope Francis is attempting to now begin to redirect, reorient the world economic system? Because certainly the Vatican is a major stakeholder in the global banking system as well.
Yeah, I actually do not. I know that some of his statements seem good, but I don't think he ever does anything to veer us away from socialism. I don't. If he is, I'm not clear. Benedict the 16th before Francis said we need a world bank. Let me comment on that though. I know we probably have a time limitation here, but that's a very important, very critical subject you brought up. and I will comment on that. But so anyway, I'll leave money there. But there is a way, there is a solution, and the economy, of course, if we stay in this system, nothing can be helped, and we're going to be crashing and burning. And the young people are told, you're in debt, it's $60 trillion, million. You'll never get out of debt. All this pessimism in the age that has more physical goods, more ability to production, this age of plenty, to quote the book, and we are supposed, because the bankers will not issue the money properly and are charging usurious interest to Greece and to all these South American countries, they're charging all this interest, and because they are manipulating money and taking the cream off the top, in this age of plenty, the greatest physical production and invention age in the history of mankind, we're told we're going to all be in debt for the rest of our life. This could be fixed, I'm telling you, in 4 to 12 months if an honest group was put in instead of the Fed, and they issued money scientifically as well as they could, with no interest of the people. And the dividend, the reason it's not socialism, and there was a Vatican study on this in 1939, is because there's no central planning. When that check goes out for the dividend, people can do whatever they want. They can buy 4 big screen TVs. They can save it. They can probably, a lot of people today would buy a newer car, or fix up their car, or they'd remodel their house. The economy would be booming in no time. So anyway, so I've now said 3 positive solutions: the precinct system, and from the precinct system we could fix the election system and the money system. Okay, now I'm going to address the question next. I maybe address one other thing,
we have enough time to cover this, believe me. As I said, you'll not be penalized, we'll get through this. So
okay, well, there's two, and I'm going to do a podcast on this with Sophia, who did the movie 9/11 Mysteries, which is one of the best movies on 9/11. And we're going to do this, and that is that this banking cartel that we're talking about is the shadow government. It has taken over 2 major parts of religion in the last 50 years. Okay, and this is important. I don't care if you're evangelical or Christian or Catholic or atheist. This is important because it has to do not. What I'm going to address it not from the angle of theology, but from the angle, again, of unnecessary control of mankind and unnecessary regimentation of mankind. Okay. One thing that happened in the 1980s is suddenly out of nowhere came all these cable channels. Jerry Falwell, John Hagee's now a big guy in this, but he's not as attractive a figure as Falwell or Pat Robertson or Jimmy Swaggart.
Well, all together, they're not a real attractive bunch of looking guys. Okay, we'll see to that.
Yeah. So at any rate, they began this Christian Zionism. So we got 40 million people. Some people say 70 million, but I usually hear the number 40 million Americans who are going to these Christian Zionist churches. And basically they've abandoned every doctrine except we must support Israel in all things. This particular entity calling itself Israel, if we say anything critical of AIPAC or the Jewish lobby, it's like striking God himself. I mean, I'd like to get a deal where nobody was allowed to criticize Jim Carter Jr.
Exactly. Yeah, me too. God, that'd be great.
And everything I did, people would have to support. And even if I was shooting people and killing them and stealing people's houses, they'd have to say, no, we have to support Jim Condit Jr. because striking him is like striking God, or criticizing him is like criticizing God. But that's what the founders. Now, this is a very important subject, and there is a leader named Dr. Robertson Jenis, okay? And he has a presentation on 3 scriptures, not one, not two, but 3 scriptures in the Old Testament that say that 1900 years before Christ, God had given his promise to Abraham, had given his promise to the Israelite and the Jews, the land of Israel. And it says God has fulfilled this promise in all ways. It is done. And he uses the Scofield Bible, which many people, Scofield was hired by the bankers to write a commentary on the Bible that actually was longer than the Bible. But on these 3 verses, it's crickets. There's no commentary at all on these 3. And all these Jewish leaders today writing books about how Christians must support Israel because God's promised, blah, blah, blah. And Sanjena says, if it really is God's promise, and if we, God has promised this land in Israel to the Jews, then Christians have to drop everything and make sure it comes true. But if it was already fulfilled, then it's over. And so that's a whole nother subject. But that takes the rug out.
I'll just say this. That was a subject that was covered for 7 years on a radio show I did called The Threshing Floor, where we
did
all of that thoroughly. Yes.
Oh, good. That's good. So you're one of the few people I've ever met that has heard of that, because I really didn't see these scriptures till recently. So
even from a Christian point of view, the covenant was fulfilled in the Old Testament. The New Covenant brought in what was called spiritual Israel, and that is not, as the Apostle Paul wrote, is not of this earth. Jesus said, "It was not my kingdom is not of this world." Israel, which is above, is referenced in the book of Galatians. So Christians can look at this. We did studies on it. It's still online. There's reference guides and everything that point to all the scriptures.
Well, what's the website on that?
It is threshingfloor-radio.com.
So say that again first.
Threshingfloor-radio.com.
Threshing floor. So a threshing,
and then hyphen radio.com. But I can send you some links for the material, because it's a pretty big website.
Okay.
That's my background.
Okay, good. That's an important subject. So we have this force of called Christian Zionism, which is basically the Tea Party, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, and they are serving this, call the synagogue of Satan, to use a phrase from Revelation 2:9 and 3:9, mm-hmm. or the Apocalypse, chapter 2, verse 9, chapter 3, verse 9. Some Catholics call it the Apocalypse in days of old.
Yes.
Or Revelation, and that talks about the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not, which is another subject on the Khazars.
Lie.
So that's one point, okay? That this unholy force called Christian Zionism, which is against the principles of Christianity. Some people say, God said that, you know, they who bless them will bless me, and that actually was made to Abraham 25 years before he was circumcised. But the point is that I say to them, well, wait a minute, if what you're saying is true, if opposing the Pharisees and the modern day Pharisees you're going to be cursed by God. Well, the first one to fall victim of that was Jesus Christ himself, because he opposed the Pharisees. They plotted to kill him. They pushed Pontius Pilate to crucify him. But is it blessing someone if you see your friend doing wrong or your brother doing wrong? Is it blessing them to say, keep on going? Don't correct them. Just tell them to keep doing the wrong. So the blessing is to stand up against them like we're trying to do here and say, no, this is wrong. You can't kill the Palestinians and try to slow genocide them so you can get more territory. But these Christian Zionists have no sense of justice, apparently, because they will justify anything that the Likud faction of Israel does under Netanyahu. And there's even many Jews in Israel who oppose this policy of Netanyahu.
Yeah.
So the second thing I wanted to bring out here in relation to your question, though, I am a Catholic. I'm a Catholic. Now, St. Irenaeus said in the second century, my name is Christian, my surname is Catholic. Catholic just means universal, meaning Christ opened the Christianity to everybody. But so we believe that the Vatican, I'm saying this as a Catholic, okay? The Vatican was taken over in 1958 by the banking system at the conclave of 1958. The conclave was hijacked.
Thank you.
Under threat.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes, thanks for saying that.
Under threat of nuclear war, and people can look at a website I put up to try to have some responsible commentary on this, whitesmoke1958.com, where 5 minutes of white smoke came up from the Sistine Chapel and no pope emerged on October 26, 1958. And then 2 days later, John the 23rd emerged to the wild cheers of the international press. And ever since then, you have a situation where the structures of the Catholic Church have been hijacked. Now, I will have to say, in response to your question, though, not only John Paul II, who was in from 1970 to 2003, Benedict occasionally and Francis do make some noises that I can agree with on this, but it seems like they're delivering us into the one world government, and the one world banking system. So we look, my faction looks at these last six individuals, John the 23rd, Paul the 6th, John Paul I, John Paul II, Benedict and Francis, as anti-popes that as Catholics, we look at, we're in the eclipse of the church, which was long prophesied. And the, eventually these, same evil faction that's occupying the White House will be booted out of the Vatican and a true pope will be restored. Now I realize not everyone's Catholic, but I'm just telling you, it's in their interest to know, even if they're an agnostic, which I think most people are becoming these days, but it's in their interest to know that Christian Zionism is an unholy force for this one world police state, and so is the Vatican. The Vatican does make noises that, you know, they'll say like they want to recognize a Palestinian state, but then Francis went to pay homage at Theodore Herzl's grave, the founder of Zionism, you know.
Right, exactly. So, yeah.
There's all kinds of mixed signals, and that's a big subject, but we believe that both of these forces are unholy forces. So anyway, that covers, that gives at least a good panoramic. We didn't talk about, I wanted to say one other thing, though. I have a video out that is on what really happened in World War II, and let me hasten to say that it's an anti-Hitler video. It's also anti-Stalin, anti-Roosevelt, and anti-Churchill, because these were four people funded up the line by the bankers to in effect play different roles. And there was some rebellion in the part of Hitler and Stalin as to where, how they wanted it to go, but they were eventually brought back into line by the bankers. And it's called the Nazi Zionist Connection. And it has been banned in 11 countries. There's a fellow in the Netherlands who uploaded a 3-hour interview that I did with Christopher John Bjerknes, who is the interviewer, except he knew a lot about it too and really added in a lot of good stuff. It's a 3-hour interview. We meant to have an hour interview. It went into 3 hours back in May of 2007. It was an internet radio show. And it's at targetfreedomusa.com. If you go to targetfreedomusa.com, the hidden history section, Nazi Zionism, you scroll down, you'll see this 3-hour YouTube. It's also on YouTube. It is named so difficult you can't remember the name. But you go there. And
is that Hitler's The Final Solution of Adolf Hitler or something like that?
That's the video. That's 2 hours and 22 minutes. Yeah. That's the video.
That's an excellent video.
Yeah, and then there's an audio radio show with Bjerknes and myself about that. That YouTube video with that radio show has been banned in 11 countries by the order of a French judge. And it's we have it on there, what countries they are. It's Poland, Austria, Germany, Israel, I believe Italy. And so the guy that put it up, a fellow in the Netherlands, said he knows everybody up there, the most controversial speakers for years. But he said it was only when I put this video up that I got my YouTube channel banned in these 11 countries. Now, the reason is because this, it tells a story that people are not supposed to, they don't want them to know it yet, because it tears the mask off of how Israel was founded and how they're going to try to bring us to World War III in the Middle East and so on and so forth. And so I believe that Israel is just a Rothschild creation mimicking prophecy that was already fulfilled. And that's why the fruits are so bad. And they're trying to head us towards World War III, sparked in the Middle East there. So these are all, you know, each one of these subjects we could probably do a whole show on. But
you could.
So that is that straightening out history there is for people is also a necessary part of, I think, of people throwing off the brainwashing and being able to again stand up without any hesitation for the principles of liberty and avoiding a horrible police state. In 1984, George Orwell called communism a boot stamping on the human face forever.
Right.
And of course, I used to think when I was younger, I thought Orwell was one of the bad guys. I now realize he was one of the good guys trying to warn us of what they had planned. And communism and socialism, especially communism, has always been a mask for this international banking force behind Goldman Sachs and the Fed and the IMF that we started this talking about in this interview.
Well, I have to say that we've covered a massive amount of information, some of it very dark and much of it, quite frankly, very hopeful, Jim. And it's been, I think this scratches the surface on so many things, but what we're going to try and do is get this video out, put these links up. And is there anything we left untouched that you want to speak to? Because I'm not constraining your time here. We do have some time left if you want to.
Okay. I guess seems to me we've covered. Okay. Yeah. The one thing we did not touch that I should touch is health freedom.
Let's go.
One of the things we got going here, and I'm sure you're very aware of all this, but this is so bad that we got to talk about it. There's a movement, thank God, of farmers and little people to keep real seeds in the hands of the people, because these moral monsters at Monsanto and other countries, they actually want to corner all the seeds and that will produce, so that each year we would have to go begging to them for seeds that would produce that year's crop, but wouldn't give us any seeds for the next year. And as a friend of mine who died in the 90s told me in the late 90s, he said, the most powerful control of people is food control, because if people got to come to you for their food and for their kids' food, they're probably not going to be rebelling against the New World Order government if they can ever get there, you know? So that is so important. Now, the other thing that is, so for instance, let's go back to this monetary thing. And let's say we were issuing a dividend. There's several problems that are really not problems, but they sound like problems. When Romney said in 2012, let me just say two things, one from Obama and one from Romney. Okay. I despise Obama for many reasons, but he said one thing that I think he told everybody the truth. He said, many of the jobs are going away because of technology and computers, and they're never coming back. Okay. As long as we don't have a big meltdown in the world, that's a true statement. The second thing is, remember, Romney said there's the 47% who are getting a check from the government. Now, that's Social Security, that's unemployment, that's welfare. Okay. Social Security, the people paid into it. So that's not exactly should be put in that number, maybe exactly. Social Security and all this stuff, though, could be ended with the dividend, though. You could basically end all that once you got made sure the system was on an even keel.
Yes.
But let's just say that I say to conservatives, and I consider myself a conservative, but I think the conservatives have not solved this money problem because we don't really have a good alternative to tell people about, like Bernie Sanders seems to. And his is a terrible solution, but that people are listening to him because they hate the Wall Street vultures so much, who should be politically hated because of what they're doing. And it is unfair, and it is a rigged system, but it's not free enterprise on an even playing field like the founding fathers envisioned. But when I say to people, well, if 47% of the people are getting a check for not doing anything, then why aren't we collapsing? Why aren't we having hyperinflation? Because you see, the Fed knows enough about what's going on. I mean, they understand that they issue enough money to keep us barely going. At least they have till now. They may someday withdraw that, but but my point is that that 47% is going to get higher if computers and robots and that stuff keeps on taking over jobs. And if people then have more leisure time, which has been the goal of mankind for thousands of years, what they really need to do, everybody needs to become organic farmers in their little neighborhood so we have real food again. I mean, that would be a worthy goal, you know? And every neighborhood have some organic food and so forth. Because right now what we got going, and this is not understood by people, and I'm just learning, I learn more all the time about it. And I'll just say one aspect of this. There's something called glyphosate or something.
Glyphosate.
Okay.
Glyphosate, yes.
And it's in, so for the layman like me, it's in a crop control pesticide called Roundup, I guess. And exactly. When you eat non-organic food, sometime this Roundup or glyphosate goes into your system and starts destroying your gut bacteria. And your gut bacteria, we now know, is what your first defense against health. So little kids are eating the Monsanto pesticides that is not only protecting the crops from the bugs, but it's starting to turn on your own body.
It's stripping. It's stripping the entire digestive tract of an entire generation of people. And it's already showing up in children. It's showing up in older people in terminal conditions of cancer. This is a plague. This whole thing is a plague. The bioengineering of our
food. Yeah, exactly. So health freedom is something that we've got to alert the people to, and they got to be alerted to how to eat, and that they need to understand that I've loved my life through my life processed food, but it's not good for you. And so we got to understand how we got to eat and how we got to protect our gut bacteria. I guess that's the right way to say it, so that you can maintain your immune system. But the powers that be at Monsanto and elsewhere seem to either not care how much damage they're doing, or many people think they're doing it deliberately to reduce the population on Earth. And so
Georgia Guidestones.
Yeah.
I read the Georgia Guidestones, and that's the blueprint that I really, honestly, cynically believe they're following. They will reduce the population to a few hundred million, enough to maintain a workforce, and the rest of us will be eradicated. And in the process, we'll just simply become a slave colony.
And of course, that's what they want. And our job is to stop them from getting there.
It is.
Now, I don't know if I can interject, and I know, you know, not everybody believes the same, but do you mind if I interject my own personal guesstimate as to what's going to happen in the near future?
No, I welcome that. Please go ahead.
Even though many people may say, Connor, you're nuts on that one. But, you know, being a pre-Vatican II, Vatican II was from 1962 to 65, right, after the Vatican was hijacked. So I'm like a pre-Vatican II Catholic. I was born in 53 and still remember things the way they were before all the changes swept through the structures of the church. But there's an event called Fatima in 1917, where Catholics believe Mary, and I know Protestants have a problem with this, but Mary, Jesus's mother, appeared to three children at Fatima. And you can look this up if you want to see the basics of what the contention is. It's in the first 30 minutes of a video called Heaven's Key to Peace. That's Heaven's Key to Peace by Father Gruner. But the prophecies that are tied in with this, and that I believe are going to happen, but I could be wrong. Let me make it clear. Whenever you're trying to pinpoint prophecy, you could be wrong. I don't believe we're headed into the end.
You're telling me. I did a radio show on prophecy for 7 years. I'm fully aware of that.
So I do not believe, as many of my good Protestant friends do, that are marching shoulder to shoulder with me in this fight to preserve liberty and against the police state. They believe we're headed in for the end of the world. I do not believe that. I believe that, there's going to be an end of the world someday. But I believe the body of prophecies that say we're already in the disintegration of church and state. This is in a book published in 1971 by Yves DuPont called Catholic Prophecy. And he then called many things that have already happened. And the one is that there will be disintegration of church and state until it looks almost hopeless. Okay. And then there will be a chastisement of mankind. Now, this is these prophecies. No one has to believe them, but you know, there were Old Testament prophecies that came true. I believe there's some that are given through holy people in the New Testament that are not in Scripture. But so then there'll be a chastisement which will befall mankind, part man-made, part God-made. And that will culminate in a 3 days of darkness, which DuPont postulates will be the tail of a comet coming through the Earth's atmosphere that will actually block out, you know, because the tail of the comet has so many particles in it that it will block out the sun for 3 days. And that's just a variation on what could happen. But he believes then the nitrogen in the tail of that comet will fall to Earth and will rejuvenate the Earth. And then we'll have a period of peace for anywhere from three generations to 500 years. And then will come the end of the world. So I believe we're going to win in the near future, even though it doesn't look like it right now. Maybe it's like the old joke when everything looks hopeless and he's hanging by his fingernails from the cliff, and he says, "We got him right where we want him."
Absolutely.
I know it doesn't look like we got him right where we want him, but I do believe we're going to have, even though it's going to be traumatic, and I think it's time for everyone, and I'm talking to myself here too, we're about to buy a generator. It's time to get a generator. It's time to get storage food. Yeah. It's time to get water, because you want at least a few months to punt if either man or God is angry with mankind or man, you know, whatever would cause a civil breakdown. And the powers that be may very well cause a big civil breakdown, you know. Or there's other theories about an EMT or EMP, where a nuclear bomb would be set out over Kansas and would be back in the dark ages. So I would say that, well, I don't say go nuts, because I've heard that we only have a year left since the 1970s. But I believe now it is very sensible for every family. I'm with the Mormons on this one. Get some water. Get some storage food and get a Berkey, where you can Berkey is a device where you can, for a few hundred bucks, where you can
gravity run feed water filter.
Yeah, so you can run mud water and dirty rivers and rainwater.
We have a preferred favorite here, marketed by our friend Jim McCanny, but the Berkeys are
what
good.
Is it?
It's a Aquacera filter. It's marketed by Professor James McCanny.
Is it? Does it do the purification of water on the run and in crisis periods?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Well, maybe we'll get that off the air. You can tell me how to get that. I got to get something though, because I got a grandkid now. So my point is, I think it's time to, like the Mormons have done for generations, to have something in case there is a total civil breakdown. They say that, like, Kroger's is our big grocery store around here. They say that the Kroger's shelves would be empty in 3 days
Just in time delivery at all grocery stores. Yep.
Yeah, I say the minute that people realized that there was going to be an interruption in the food supply, try 3 hours before once the people get wind of it. Kroger's and all the grocery stores.
We had a major snowstorm here 2 weeks ago. The grocery store 2 days before the storms were packed. People were hauling off all kinds of stuff for a snowstorm. Imagine what it's going to be like when, let's just say the substance hits the oscillator. So,
Right. So I guess, you know, I hope that we've given some hope here. The networkamerican.org, go in and join with all of us in organizing in our counties and in our precincts. We can then take back the country peacefully and under that center, and then fix the money, fix the Congress, undo all these police state laws, stop all the unnecessary wars. So maybe I can end with Father Gruner, my friend who died earlier this year, or was it last year? Yeah, it was last year. It was in March of last year. We were sitting around up at his place in Canada 20 years ago, and people were talking about, you know, how, you know, a lot of things were going against the way they should. A lot of things were going in the wrong direction. And we talked to him, and he said, if we work as hard as we can and we pray as hard as we can, then God will do the rest. And I believe that is true. And we should go forward with a realistic view, but also a joyful and a hopeful view.
Perfect words to end the show. Jim Condit, you and I probably need to have many more conversations together. This has been marvelous. We covered a lot of material, and I really deeply appreciate you taking the time to be on tonight. Go out letting people know where they can find you, a website.
Okay. Yeah. My congressional website is letfreedomring2016.com. There'll be work done on that. Our issues website is targetfreedomusa.com. That's targetfreedomusa.com. And an easy one to remember that has the election fraud story, openlettertodonaldtrump.com.
Right. Very good. Excellent talking to you, my friend. We're going to head out here.
And, thanks for having me.
My pleasure to have you on. If you want to stay on the line for a minute, we can talk once we go off. That's going to wrap it up for this week. February. It's a short month, so I guess next week's the last show for February. We'll get something together. We'll do it then. This is Off Planet TV, Off Planet Radio. I'm Randy Moggins. The truth is out there. It's inside you. Now, go find it. See you next time.